my resurrection song. This is my hallelujah call. This is why it's to you alone.
Oh my.
This is my resurrection song. This is my hallelujah call.
Say in the, some of you were there at lunch for the, with the teens. Didn't the one girl say that it was sixth grade? That's when she started, right? She was in sixth grade when she started using marijuana. And it just breaks your heart, doesn't it? So, wow. So, well, we can talk about that later. You guys ready to sing?
All right, we're going to start with At Calvary. It's 236, or just look up on the screen. I think the words are there. And Ruth Ann said I can let you stay seated. So if you want to stand up, you can, but it's up to you, totally. But we're going to sing. She's sitting, but yeah. And I'm standing, so it can be either way. It's up to you. We're going to start with verse 1.
Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified, knowing not it was for me he died on Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. By God's word at last my sin I learned. Then I trembled at the light's burn, till my guilty soul imploring turned to Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan. Oh, the grace that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty gulf that God did span at Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdens all found liberty at Calvary.
And then glory to his name.
Glory to his name. down at the cross where my Savior died, down where for cleansing from sin I cried, there to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name, glory to his name, glory to his name, there to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. I am so wondrously saved from sin, Jesus so sweetly abides within. There at the cross where he took me in, glory to his name, glory to his name, glory to his name, there to my heart was the blood applied, glory to his name. Oh, precious fountain that saves from sin, I am so glad I have entered in. There Jesus saves me and keeps me clean. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Come to this fountain so rich and sweet. Cast thy poor soul at the Savior's feet. Plunge in today and be made complete. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name.
What's God been teaching you this week? Patience? Yes. I've got an echo going on back there. Well, I can turn that off. I'll turn it off while you guys keep telling me what God's doing. What else is God doing in your life? One day at a time, all right. Anything else? I think that's off. There we go. One of the studies that I've been working with, I think it was with our teens, they said a no decision is a no decision. I'm like, what? And you have to think through that. But if you refuse to make a decision, you're saying no. And so when people are saying, well, I'm going to wait, I'm going to do this, you're not making a decision. A no decision turns into a no decision. So challenging our teens not to make those not to make a no decision. Make a decision for Christ, you know. So that was kind of exciting. And then I wanted to remind you that on November 5th, we're having the Right Now Media Conference, and it's going to be live stream. So depending on how many people show up, we'll either be here or we'll be in the teen room. We'll be able to watch it. And if you'd really want to watch but you don't want to come, there's a link on the bulletin that tells you where you can watch it at home. I have been to one of those conferences live. Incredible sessions. The speakers that they have on those are just incredible. So take a chance. Take some time out of your day. You don't have to log in for the whole day. You could just listen to one or two of the speakers if you want to. But let God speak to you through that Right Now Media. Any other prayer requests? We need to pray for Carol Hall. Anybody heard an update on her today? Okay. She's still having a lot of pain. And she said that she had some swelling still in the knee. And it's still warm, and so that's not good. So we want to pray for Carol Hall. We want to pray for John and Debbie. They should be at the cabin by now, I would assume. So we need to pray and just that God would give him a time of rest during the sabbatical, and that he would restore and renew his heart. So let's go to the Lord in prayer, and we're just going to pray individually, and then I will close. So if anybody wants to pray out loud, feel free to do that. You can pray silently, and then I'll close us in prayer, and then we'll move on to some more music. So let's pray. Father, as we come to you this evening, we want to lift up Carol to you. We just ask that you will touch her. Give the doctors wisdom. And Father, we just pray that you'll take away the pain that's in her leg and that you will just heal her up, Father. We ask that you be with Pastor John as he's on sabbatical. We just ask that you will just give him such a time of renewal and refreshing while he's away. Father, help him not to be concerned about everything that's going on at Salina First. Father, let him just be an empty vessel for you to fill. May you speak to him through the books and through his word, through your word. And Father, we just pray that you will just refresh him, that you will just help his depression, help things that he's struggling with. Father, we just pray that you would just heal him, that you would just wrap your arms around him and love him, Father. We just ask that you'll hold them close this week, in the next couple of weeks, if they're on sabbatical. And then, Father, we just, as Marla prayed, we pray for our election, Father, and we just pray that your will be done. Father, help us as a nation to turn our eyes and our hearts back to you. You are the true hope for our nation. And, Father, we just pray that you will move in this election to bring people to come back to you. Father, that is the prayer of our church. That is the prayer of our nation, that we will turn our eyes back to you. Father, I just ask that you will be with Jeff tonight as he brings your message. Father, I just ask that you'll anoint his words. We are so thankful that he's here and able to speak with us tonight. Father, I just ask that you will encourage him and his family as well. In Jesus' blessed name.
So precious is Jesus, my Savior and King. His praise all the day long with rapture I sing. To him in my weakness for strength I can cling. For he is so precious to me. For he is so precious to me. For he is so precious to me. His heaven below, my Redeemer to know. For he is so precious to me. He stood on the mountain. at last. No cloud in the heavens, a shadow to cast. His smile is upon me, the valley is past. For he is so precious to me. For he is so precious to me. I praise him because he appointed a place where someday through faith in his wonderful grace, I know I shall see him and look on his face. For he is so precious to me. For he is so precious to me. His heaven below, my Redeemer to know, for he is so precious to me.
And then surely goodness and mercy.
Okay. A pilgrim was I and a wandering. In the cold night of sin I did roam. When Jesus the kind shepherd found me, and now I am on my way home. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days, all the days of my life. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. He restoreth my soul when I'm weary. He giveth me strength day by day. Beside the still waters, he guards me each step of the way. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days. Days of my life. When I walk through the dark, lonesome valley, my Savior will walk with me there, and safely his great hand will lead me to the mansions he's gone to prepare. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever, and I shall feast at the table spread for me. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
All right, Jeff, come share with us. Do you have a mic on or not? Let me get you a mic, too. Well, as It's also better for online. Because they won't hear you without one.
I'm on. All right. I love these things. I can breathe real heavy. There it goes. I'm already starting. I'll drop it down a little bit. Good evening. I should go running down there with my hands up in the air, but that was 20 years ago. So, first off, you know, some of the blessings that happen in our life, we never really realize them. Unfortunately, sometimes until it's pretty late. And some of the blessings that we have in our life are just, they're wonderful and they're powerful. And you have to mature a little bit to really appreciate them. Like glasses. You know, I never thought I'd ever have to wear them. But now that I do, I realize, because I never thought I'd live to be 30 years old when I was younger. You know what? And hair, you know? The blessing is all the money I'm saving now on shampoo, you know? And I tell the youth that I work with daily, you know, okay, so I'm fat and bald, and you don't understand the blessings I've had in life because of this. But I have them because I have been blessed. Isn't it funny, some of the things that happen in our life? Today, what was it? Team challenge. I don't know about some of y'all, but I actually found tears in my eyes at points listening to some of their testimonies and their stories. I get to work with that every day, the product of that. Don't forget your blessings in life. And as you sit here tonight, and as you start to look around, I hope you do realize that the person sitting next to you and across from you has been brought into your life to be a blessing too. Amen? Amen. I want to share with you all tonight something that was laid upon my heart a while back. And I have to admit something else that's a blessing is the ability to write, because I have to keep my thoughts completely organized now. Some of the things that I thought were blessings in my younger days have turned out to be hindrances in my older. So that I don't stand up here and babble like a fool, I kind of write things down. But I have to begin with, have you ever noticed that each of us can come up with a lot of conclusions about many different things in life? Some of them are right, and they lead to a very productive ending. While others might be wishful, off track, or simply wrong. And their cost for us can be educating and provide some useful experience if we'll only accept and learn the lesson of the mistake. That's probably been the hardest thing for me to have to learn in life, you know that? Is that I do need to grow from all of my mistakes. It will produce a blessing. Because if we don't, They can become the fuel for destruction, especially upon the lips of the unforgiving. And I pray that doesn't happen. Here recently, I came to a conclusion as I was out and I gazed upon an enormous beaver dam. A whole bunch of ideas began to kind of lighten up my thoughts as I looked upon the family of beavers as they were collectively working for the purpose of their family. One thought just kind of kept popping through my head as I thought about this over and over. It's in Romans 14:19. It says, "So when we pursue things which make for peace and for building one another up, blessing." It really is. It's blessings. You see, that's really not all, because I remembered how a few years earlier, this same den of beavers, they'd lost everything. In a torrential rain, their whole lodge was washed out of this gully. And the only thing that was left was some stinky black mud and the outline of where their pond used to be. Now, what had replaced the old lodge, as I looked upon it, was even more inspiring than before. It was quite big. It was, in fact, a lot bigger. And deep down inside, I wanted to understand the drive of a beaver. As I began to read a little bit about their productivity, as I looked up some of the details on them, their descriptions and everything that we've ever heard about a beaver seems to fit them pretty well. Can you imagine a giant rodent? It weighs maybe up to 100 pounds, some of them. Building a structure out of sticks, grasses, and moss and mud. Plastering them together with their tail. You know, their tail is made perfect for doing that. Smoothing it down. You know, that's a blessing when you can actually take the time to appreciate some of the things in life. But what I noticed about this particular dam and lodge, which, by the way, was several yards long. In fact, it was somewhere between 10 to 12 yards across. And it was almost 3 yards high. That's almost 10 feet, you know that? And the pond that it created was over 6 feet deep. And it was as long, if not longer, than a football field. A giant rat, that's right, a giant-sized rodent built that structure with no tools and no machines. Do you know why this creature accomplished this? Because God gave the beaver a purpose. Gave it a purpose in its life. It gave it a place and a niche to serve God's will. And the beaver never turns away from its task. Never. Let's take a look at some of our purposes in life. How many of you like to build things? Anybody here like to build things, you know? You know, the possibilities can be endless. Some people make some very big gardens, build really big gardens of different kinds. Even various distribution systems. Some build cars. Anybody build cars? Yeah, any collectors here? How about trucks? Bikes, motorcycles, houses, homes, buildings. The point that I'm wanting to bring out is when you complete your project, how do you feel? You feel pretty good about it, don't you? I don't know about you, but it's an awesome feeling. It really is. It's a sense of satisfaction, isn't it? Really, it is. You know, I built house and buildings years ago, and I still enjoy that feeling when I drive by them today. Is it just me, or do any of you feel that same accomplishment, you know? Cliff, every time I walk into the foyer out there, brother, I praise you up and down. That's an accomplishment. Many, many people have devoted much of their time, the outside of the church right now. Trust me, I remember cleaning up that rock garden up front one day. Wow. It looks awesome. Some wonderful accomplishment. But have you ever noticed that wherever things and success seem to be enjoyable, wherever the positives are, the envy and strife and jealousy are always close behind, ready to steal the joy away? You ever notice that? Why is that, you know? If our focus then is what it tells us in Romans 15:2, if each of us is to please his neighbor for his good and for his edification, to build him up, the strength of the church will begin to grow, and it grows through our neighbors within. When we support one another, like the body of a church, we grow together. Does anybody feel like doing a little building up here tonight with me? You know, we know God's purpose for us, and Jesus is the perfecter of our faith. He has chosen us, and he has given us his blueprints in the Bible, if you will. And we've been called to make disciples of the nations. You know, and as Nazarenes, we are called to go out and to make Christ-like disciples. How'd that go? A no decision?
Yeah, no decision is a no decision.
Exactly. There's no question there. It's go and do. We need to return our focus to God's word. We need to build the house of prayer that Jesus has called us to construct. And we need to build one another up. Tonight I'd like to share a little bit with you out of Ephesians 4, and I'm going to be reading verses 12 through 16 out of the New King James. It calls for the equipping of saints for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come to the unity of the faith and to the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of stature of the fullness of Christ, that we should no longer be children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine, not by the trickery of men and the cunning craftiness and deceitful plotting, but in speaking the truth in love. May grow up in all things into him who is the head, Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share. Growth causes growth for the body, for the edification of love, of itself in love. As I reflect upon building, my thoughts are related also to how Nehemiah, for some reason I was involved in a very extensive Sunday study, or excuse me, Saturday study, and I truly appreciate Nehemiah's building of the church. Building of the temple. Nehemiah understood what building meant. Just like you and I today, he faced problems finding provisions, dealing with opposition, and the development within all of us while addressing the varying facets of human nature. That's kind of deep, isn't it? Anybody ever get tired? You know, they say that that's when you push on, right? Is when you're tired. I think there's something to that. I also believe that training a replacement. Anybody have that same thought as me? I always like to share everything that I know because I feel like I'm always trying to train a replacement. I'm not trying to hide. I'm looking for help. Are you? You know, isn't that why you kind of teach people how to do something? You can't carry the whole load. And too many times, too many of us want to. That's our human nature. And then we get tired, don't we? And what happens when we have carried the load so long and we get tired? We get frustrated, don't we? And we start to look for avenues, excuses even. Can I ask how many of you have tried to accomplish something and felt as if everyone was against you? You ever felt that way? Or as if they wanted you to fail or to even quit? You know, Nehemiah faced the same thing, didn't he? He faced the same thing, and they accused him falsely, trying to further their own cause. Nehemiah's greatest adversaries, much like all of us today, were just people who simply wanted to see him fail. Tobiah and Sambalay repeatedly intimidated Nehemiah, for all they wanted to do was to frighten them, thinking that their hands will drop from their work and it will not be done. But now, God, strengthen my hands. That's Nehemiah 6:9. If you take nothing from my message tonight, take this. But now, oh God, strengthen my hands. Strengthen my hands. Because I don't know about you and me, but it seems like those that can drag us down at times, and some of the things that really cripple us the most emotionally is when those that go to great lengths to impress a lie. You've experienced that, haven't you? Or the costs incurred to continue on, to continue to cover it up. It gets pretty deep, doesn't it? And Nehemiah faced that same thing. And right here is an example of God's will in the lives of man. Nehemiah had found favor in God's eyes. And there was no turning back. The king was already supplying everything that was set for him, all the provisions to rebuild the temple. Deep in his heart, Nehemiah knew the coming changes in power. And then with his eyes focused, he completed God's task that was set out for him. Something that he realized was that his best defense was the distance that he kept. You ever notice that sometimes you just got to stay away from somebody? Don't you? We do, all of us. There are others who have faced opposition in their walk. And I often think about a couple of differences between the Old Testament and the New Testament Sauls. Both had unique places in the kingdom, if you will. The Saul of the Old Testament would disregard God's will and would lose favor from the Lord's eyes, eventually surrendering the crown to a man after God's own heart. In contrast, between the Old and the New Testament, this is the part that I really enjoy the most, is that the New Testament Saul would impose the ideals of God's intentions upon the lineage of man after God's own heart. And be refreshed anew. Once again, showing the death of the law in the old and the transforming grace of the New Testament. Every one of us in this sanctuary has had to deal with our own Sambalays and Tobias. There seems to always be something that tries to make us fall short. But all of you here tonight, all of you, church, we have a Redeemer who sits at the right hand of God, and he has not abdicated the throne in any way. He is there to lift you up in spirit. You see, building a church requires a solid foundation. And right here before my eyes tonight are the necessary supplies and the saints that God has chosen to build this church. Let's forget our troubles for a moment. And let's forget the naysaying that all of us have become accustomed to at some point in our lives. And let's focus on that scripture from Ephesians tonight. Can we? Are you with me? You know, verse 12 reads equipping in some versions and perfecting the saints in others. In any way you look at it, Nehemiah would utilize the talents of those within the walls to complete the sections of those walls and the gates by those who were closest to the sections that were damaged, the things that were in need of repair. Paul's reflection here in Ephesians also capitalizes on mending a breach, completing a connection, and putting a dislocation in order. Paul is showing that each of our divine gifts, each one of us has a divine gift, and for the effect of either sharing, preaching, teaching, government, for the service of our Lord. All of us here tonight, all of us that are watching, and anybody who will see this message, you have a gift that you have been given from the Lord. Amen? The work of service is to spiritually enable and to build up or edify each one of us independently, so that collectively, as the body of Christ, as a congregation, we can go out and we can gather new members, new living stones, through the holy influence given to us in the Great Commission of the church, because Christ has given us this power through his advocate, the Holy Spirit. All of us. As we're sharing in verse 13, it becomes inclusive to all of us within the service of the Lord that there are no independents within the body of Christ. We are all a family here tonight, amen? All of us, we're all a family. We each have a collective responsibility to be united in faith and to spiritually develop a harmonious knowledge of the Son of God. Maturity and full assurance are the results of edification by the body. All the branches, all the limbs incorporated, everything will give to the head and this mystical body, his sacred body, a life and a fullness which flows from Christ. Guarding the truth so reverently spoken as it brings together in unity one Christ, both glorious head and sanctified body, full of grace and glory. Are you full of grace and glory tonight? Amen. Amen. Thank you, because that's the truth, isn't it? You know, a lot of times we don't realize that we are his grace and his glory. We are the light that is to go into the world and for others to see. We are to bring those that don't know Christ into a relationship with him through our example. Our example. How often do we struggle today? I can tell you at times, I struggled immensely. Not so much in action, but in deed. In the way within I interpreted the word of God, I forgot about grace and forgiveness. Because I've been there, and I've come to where I am now. And it's, you could say it's full circle, but it's something only God can do in somebody's life. Amen? Because as he shares with us in 14, if we're no longer children, move back and forth by the influences of the moment. The moment that the world is steered by. Isn't that the truth today? Isn't that the truth? You know, we're about to come into the holiday season, and we are all going to see the world being steered at the moment, aren't we? We're being steered by it right now. I have made all the jokes I can make about the mask and about the corona, and it's taken a toll on all of us, isn't it? It's isolating us. Some people say it's making us nastier and meaner. And I have to tell him I agree with him, because every time I go to the store, my wife reminds me to put my mask on. And I ask her, why, are you embarrassed of me or what, you know? But no, honestly, the world in which we live today and what is steering us, those of us that are spiritually mature, who can overcome the carnality of those who lead astray, who is Christ in your life? And do you profess him? Are you his example? Are you a reflection of Christ in the eyes of others? That's a tough question for us. You know what I like to tell people? I gave up being perfect a long time ago because Jesus is perfect in my life. And it's only through him. It is only through him, by the grace of God tonight, that I am standing up here before all of you. Some serious lessons we can all learn. Even like from the people that we saw earlier today from the Teen Challenge. Because I promise you, the world of the moment, they can tell you all about it. You see, the inequity of the third and fourth generation, we're being inundated by it today, right now. It's hard to see the true reflection of Jesus Christ in our society today, isn't it? And those of us sometimes that are the true reflection, ask yourself, are we huddled up in the room just like the disciples, waiting for the Holy Spirit to come and do something? Because I'm going to tell all of you right now, we've already been given that power. And we're to go out into this world and serve others, no matter how tired we are. Today, we're inundated by our needs to be recognized by others. The world is definitely this way today. Through the things of the social media. Boy, the social media today is amazing, isn't it? Which has become so sensual and misleading that many are failing to recognize the deceit and the craftiness imposed by the wiles of the devil. Cambridge Bible Commentary makes a quote that I really appreciated. It says that the apostle recognizes in this verse, but I like to say the saints too, recognizes and exposes a sad fact of intentional misguidance on the part of these preachers of another gospel. I've heard a lot of people say a lot of things about Jesus Christ. But I don't know about you, but I believe in a contrite heart. Amen? I believe that redemption comes when redemption is asked for. And change truly occurs in our life. Because it seems like today that every modification that all of us have been exposed to seems to lead us further and further away from the truth. We also need to highlight, we need to live this, that edification, the building of each other up, is teaching. And it's not deceiving, because faith is trust. Amen? You have to trust one another, don't you? That's what faith is all about. In 15, there's highlights that this fact of faith, that we must be able to depend on one another as followers of Jesus Christ. We must avoid the counterfeits of life. Our spiritual development and growth must conform to the head as Christ and the body, his church. Together, all things, spirit, soul, and body. As we bring this all together tonight, we should recognize each other's importance in edifying the body of Jesus Christ. Take a little time right now. Look around at each other. There's some very important people here. There's some real lovers of Jesus. Amen? And you can't do it all by yourselves, can you? We can't. But each one of us needs to mentor another. True? So that we can pass this along and pass this down. Somebody to help carry the load, because that's what Jesus did for me. And I'm sure he did the same thing for each one of you. Our responsibility of service is the whole body joined together, knit, isn't it? Knit together with a common purpose and equipped with confidence that our works are properly promoting the growth. The growth that builds itself in love. Church, all of you here tonight, we need to begin looking for ways to promote one another. We need to look for ways to promote one another. It's as simple as a compliment to somebody else that somebody else hears. You know that? It really is. It's by building each other up. And we will all become benefactors, and collectively, the church begins to grow, doesn't it? When people begin to see something within a body, they want to be a part of it. Some things to think about in the week ahead. As we come into this holiday season, is everybody ready for the holidays? Yeah? You know, I tell you what, when I first sat down and I was thinking about the holidays coming, I have to confess, this is our time to shine, isn't it? This really is our best time to shine, because we can really begin to make a difference in people's lives. One thing at a time. One action at a time. And all the credit, honor, and glory in Jesus' name. True? Amen. As a church, we must shine the light of redemption as the glory and honor of and as his chosen. Do you believe that in your heart tonight? Because if you are fearfully and wonderfully made, I believe that you are his glory and honor. You're his reflection. And you've been called to go and build his church. You see, our loyalties are to Christ, and our allegiance is greater and trustworthy. It demands our feelings and personal involvement and to trust in him. Our trust is not only the prerequisite of love, but it is also the nucleus of our faith. Because it is here that obedience is proven in reliability and loyalty. Trust then becomes the confidence of something that we value. We value each other and we value Christ in our lives. Our confidence is something that shines. It's the radiance of joy enabling and promoting others of our own loyalty, our trusts, and it's leading those in promoting the life-giving steps associated with the leap of faith. You see, confidence is the product of spirit-filled edification, building each other up in the Spirit. If our focus then is each of us to please his neighbor for his good and his edification, as it says in Romans 15:2, we will begin to fulfill our calling through the Great Commission. If each of us remembers our purpose in life, our place, our niche, you might say, as members of the body of Christ, then just like that beaver, that family of beavers I told you about, we will serve God's will. And we can never turn away from the task. Amen? God bless you all. Can I close for you guys tonight in prayer? Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, tonight, through your presence, may your message radiate through the hearts of all that have heard. May each of us as we leave here become the joy of enabling others, Lord. May we share that grace, that glory, and that honor. May we lift you up, Lord, for all to see. Lord, I know tonight that we have those that are unable to attend, that we have those who ask for us to pray for them, and that there are those that just need our prayers, Lord. We ask that you find a way for each of us to approach and to share the love of Christ with those who might not know you. We ask that those that have prayers, both physically and spiritually, Lord, that through this week that you find a way to answer each of them so that they can share your glory with all of them in their lives. And Lord, tonight, I just want to say thank you. I just want to say thank you for the grace that has brought me into a life filled in a relationship with you. May all honor and glory be in your name. For it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen.